today about recent study we've carried out in the UK to compare the way we evaluate mixtures across different laboratories carrying out profiling for the police in the UK. So we've done this under the banner of the AFSP, which is the Association of Forensic Science Providers. I'll say a little bit more about that in a couple of slides' time. Okay, so this collaborative exercise, as I just said, from the UK to compare methods and outcomes for evaluation of complex mixtures. The aim of this really was to update a study that was carried out in 2014, which had been commissioned by the forensic science regulator in the UK. When we originally talked about updating this study, we were originally intending to carry out a completely fresh study with a completely new set of mixtures. But on discussion, in fact, we decided that there was a lot of value in just repeating the analysis of the same set of mixtures that we used in 2014, really to discover how we will move forward in our ability to evaluate and report simple and complex mixtures. So we suggested reusing the samples, reusing the data, reusing the case circumstances that had been initially used in the 2014 study, with the advantage that was much simpler for us to initiate for anyone who's trying to set up provisional test trials. It's an awful lot of work to create mixtures and to distribute them to participants, etc. So much simpler, no new materials, no new samples to prepare. But of course there are some shortcomings in using the same materials as well. We were limited to using the same mixture configurations that have been originally put together 4 years earlier. And of course, there's some risk of bias that the same practitioners are asked to do the interpretation 4 years down the line, and they still remember what the correct outcomes of the studies were. So there's some risks, some benefits to reusing the same data set. So just a quick overview of the original trial 4 years ago. As I say, this was commissioned by the Forensic Science Regulator in the UK, but was designed and delivered by two independent groups, Principal Forensic Services and NIST in the States, who obviously quite a lot of experience in putting together this sort of evaluation exercise. So, in that initial trial, five separate DNA images were provided, each accompanied by a mock casework scenario that varied from very simple two-person mixtures to more complex three-person. So, they were all two of three, so that's is initially some limitation. We aren't going beyond three-person mixtures in this particular exercise. So four of those mixtures were provided to participating labs as DNA samples, mixed DNA samples for them to PCR and process as they would do in their own laboratories. And one of the mixtures was provided as a pre-processed FSA data file, which we prepared by NIST to include some specific features of low-level DNA, such as dropping which engineered into the profile. So that's what happened 4 years ago. And the outcomes of that initial study, well, it was completed in August 2014, which was actually quite a tricky time for me in the UK because we literally just moved over on a national level to reporting all our profiles using the DNA 17 kits. So prior to that, UK labs were all using SWG Plus, and we all moved as well onto DNA 17, so that pretty much coincided with this initial trial. As far as evaluation mixtures, most of that, at that time, we're using in-house programs using binary or discrete models for two-person good quality profiles, so around the assumption of no dropout and no drop-in, generally speaking. We did have some access to other more complex or more sophisticated LR models. Continuous models were starting to be used, but at that time not widely available. So where it wasn't possible to carry out statistical evaluations at that time, the outcomes of this test showed that the laboratories were giving narrative conclusions of varying kinds for complex mixtures, where the binary models that they had available to them were not appropriate. So where there was access to other models for interpretation, there were a number of different approaches labs were using at that time. Some were using the available open source softwares that were around. Others were outsourcing those analyses to other organisations and individuals. an initial trial and a quote from the final report was that the study emphasised a pressing need for a more consistent approach to mixture evaluation and interpretation, and I think we all agreed with that. So 4 years down the line, what have we done now? Well, we've decided that we'd reanalyse four of the five previously used mixtures. The one case that was originally provided as a data file was not compatible with one of the new software models because the parameters that are required to use those models weren't available for that particular case. So we reanalyzed four of the five previously used mixtures. Labs were given the choice to either retest residual DNA that they still had stored from that initial study, or indeed they could reevaluate the original data set that they produced at the time of that was felt to be appropriate. As in the original study, we invited each participating lab to submit up to four different sets of results representing different reporting officers or reporting scientists across the organisation. That happened for most of the participants. And we also invited the use of more than one software and evaluation tool if that was what was being used in those particular organisations. And we asked the actual LRs calculated by whatever software and model that they were using were reported as long within any cap figures. So it's certainly current practice in the UK to cap LRs to 1 billion, for example, and ask labs to report the actual raw calculated figure as well, which was, I think, a very informative addition to this study. So this was sent out in December last year, and we received all the results in March of this year. Okay, so these are the participant laboratories. I mentioned the AFSP earlier on. So the AFSP is an association representing the interests of the major forensic science providers in the UK and Ireland. As I'm sure most of you know, for England and Wales, all of the DNA testing for the police is carried out by three main commercial providers. They're listed at the top here. So the three main providers are Cellmark, Eurofins Forensic Services, and Key Forensic Services, fifth on the list there, are providing DNA services to police forces of England and Wales. Forensic Science Ireland, obviously, so the Irish Police, Forensic Science Northern Ireland, and the Scottish Police Authority, serving the Northern Ireland and Scottish Police, respectively. We also invited King's Forensics to participate because they've been contributing to the original. Successfully using points to help me. Okay, so a quick summary of the methodology used by the laboratories in the study. Here's the seven contributors across the top. You can see there's one of the multiplexes used in the UK. We're all using the DNA 17, with the exception of one laboratory at the Atlanta Global Finals, so they have more nice than the others. CE platforms, analytical thresholds, you can see there in between contributors, and that may have an impact on exactly which alleles are included in different calculations for different laboratories. And a key difference here at the bottom of the software is you can see that the majority of labs use SDR Mix, Star Mix. There's two laboratories using different softwares, and that's I think a really interesting feature of this exercise. One laboratory using the freeware LRMix Studio and Euroformix, so the open source software that's available, and one laboratory using Lyra, which is a software built and devised in house by other participants. So, okay, so the next few slides will describe the results in this format. So what I'm showing here is the along the bottom here we've got different contributing labs. Each lab is represented by a different colour. Where there's more than one contributing individual to that lab, you can see three or four or two dots of the same colour. And on the side here we've got the likelihood ratio on a log 10 scale reported by the lab for that particular scenario. So this first one is the first case, it's a two-person, four-to-one mixture conditioned on the victim A with a suspect D. So this is a fairly straightforward mixture calculation with the alternative hypothesis are A plus suspect or A plus unknown. And what this shows is that we are seeing a high level of consistency between and within contributors, with the LRs reported between 10 to the 18 and 10 to the 20. Across the board, with just one or two exceptions. And as we go through these next few slides, I'm going to go through them fairly quickly because I know I've not got very much time. But you see there is some wobble around. There's the occasional reported LR that's higher or lower than the rest. But I think overall, as you'll see, there's a very high level of consistency both between different contributors, therefore between different softwares, and between different individuals within an organisation. And really no systematic differences that we can see. Just one other feature I'm going to mention though is that we also included the ability to use more than one software, and some laboratories reported both using a continuous model which didn't account for weeknights and also using a discrete model which didn't account for weeknights. I'm going to show on these next few slides as well that these five dots here on the right-hand side represent two different discrete models, Lyra 1.2 and LRMix, neither of which use peakites. We can see the difference between the continuous models and the discrete models as we go through, and that varies depending on case circumstances and case time. Finally, I'm also going to show on these charts that some of these results are from 22 SDR loci from Global File, and we'll see a consistent difference between adding in a few more loci. Okay, so just sticking with case one from one further slide, then there's an alternative hypothesis proposed for case one, which was that the brother of the suspect had actually been the perpetrator, and laboratories were asked to calculate that scenario as well. And when this study was originally carried out 4 years ago, very few laboratories were able to offer a calculation for that. It was now very reassuring to see that everybody is able to do that in the current models that are available. And again, you see a high degree of consistency between the outcomes of the different models here. And once again, we add in the discrete and the additional marker sets. You can see again that adding in more markers gives you a little bit more value in terms of overall LR. Okay, as I say, I'm not going to really dwell very much on going through these in detail, but I'll just whiz through that. Case two here is another two-person mix, this time without a conditioning profile. You might have noticed previously that the contributions from the yellow lab in the first case were a little bit lower down, but now, as I say, there's no real consistent trends in this particular case example, that they're all back up there with the other LRs corresponding. Here again, the significant reduction if you remove the consideration of peakites and use a discrete model, and there's the lower file that was once again. Case 3 was a three-person conditioned profile. There we can see the results again, one laboratory reduced allowance. We believe that's probably because that particular lab has a slightly higher analytical threshold than the other laboratories in terms of weak samples, so there's more, there's a greater chance that they miss some weak leaks, not included them in their calculations. That's the same mixture with the discrete and the global finite. And finally, in case law, which was another three-person mixture, this time the bed conditioning profile. So this was the most complex model we did include in this study. And there were two separate hypotheses, or sets of hypotheses, related to different contributors to this mixture. So we had two suspects, T and S, and laboratories generally calculated those likelihood ratios independently. So T plus two unknowns over three unknowns, and S plus two unknowns over three unknowns as their separate sets of hypotheses which were used to make these calculations. But you can see in this scenario where we have got a larger number of peaks, a larger number of unknown contributors that may be contributing to a slightly greater degree of variation both within and across participants, as they make slightly different decisions about which it is to include in those calculations and which to exclude. That's the same data sets again with the discrete and the double fine. So that's really covers the outcomes of the LR calculations. What else did we look at? Well, we looked at the wordings that the different labs have used in their reporting, in particular how clearly they stated the alternative propositions relating to each LR calculation. And again, it's very encouraging, I think, now to find that across the UK there was a really consistent clarity in stating the propositions and in stating the appropriate level of proposition in most of these cases at the subsource level, as shown. And we also looked at where the labs had expressed their likelihood ratios using a verbal scale to give an indication of the strength of evidence that may be more acceptable to juries. There's still a bit of a mixed approach to that in the UK, I think. Most participants stated the LR values only, so didn't give a verbal expression of the weight of that evidence in those cases. But there were terms, within that, there was a slight degree of variation as to whether the laboratories said a value that was greater than a billion or the order of 1 billion. Personally, I don't think that makes a huge amount of difference to the perception of that by a jury. But there were a couple of instances where providers did give a verbal weight of evidence and express the likelihood ratio obtained in words such as, in my opinion, the DNA results provide extremely strong support for the proposition that Mr. B has contributed DNA to the mixed profile result obtained. What I would say is that although that was not universally used across all the different contributors, where they did use that, they were entirely consistent as to the verbal wording that was used to relate to a particular level of likelihood ratio. Okay, so just to summarise, I think this exercise demonstrated that in the UK and Ireland, all ISFGs are now able to offer continuous model calculations with at least three-person mixtures. In fact, I think that extends to four-person mixtures, but they weren't included here. There are high levels of consistency between different practitioners within FSPs, and I think very good levels of consistency between FSPs as well, and importantly, between different continuous models that we use in this study. And as we might expect, it demonstrates that the Eastern ones, which include weak lines, add value over discrete models, i.e., giving a higher LR in cases where each of these are the truth as it was in these scenarios. So I think it's a very useful data set to help us support the use of these models in court. They've come under scrutiny, as we might expect from the EU approach, and some of the data set will help us to demonstrate that. These are consistent and well accountable ways of expressing the value of our evidence in court. So, acknowledgements to all the participants here from the different laboratories, also to FSP and the forensic science regulator and the originators of the original trial data.